The Rise of Skywalker novelization by Rae Carson was able to do some things a little better than the movie, in my opinion. One of those things was just giving the story a chance to slow down a bit and explore the characters, their motivations, and their inner thoughts a little more. With that came some answers to questions I've had since the film released, and I'm going to go through those today. Let's start with the big one, the Emperor. How did he survive the Battle of Endor? If you've read Dark Empire, this is all gonna sound pretty familiar. Basically, as he was free-falling down the second Death Star, he transferred his consciousness into a clone body out on Exegol. It was a contingency he started planning, having stolen the concept from Darth Plagueis before his master could implement it. But he didn't expect Vader to betray him, so the clone body wasn't ready. Since we found out for sure Palpatine was a clone in Episode 9, people have been wondering, why not be young again? The body was young, but the nature of the dark side caused it to fall apart quickly to the point where he's going to be dead very soon by the time of the movie, which makes the ticking clock on the plot make a little more sense. But yeah, the answer is the same as it was in Legends. I've said this before, but I guess I'm fine with this explanation. I don't really like clones of main characters, but I honestly don't think there's any answer to this that would have made me feel better about Palpatine returning in the story. That he's back at all is such a meh idea to me. It wasn't the lack of an explanation in the movie that was my big problem. But from there, let's move on to Rey's parents. Apparently, her father is also a clone of Palpatine and not a natural-born son of Sheev. Since the clone body was falling apart, the Sith cultists did everything they could to create a new host for his spirit to inhabit, but nothing was working. The best they got was the person we know to be Rey's father. He wasn't genetically identical to Palpatine, and he also didn't have any powers in the Force, which I guess meant he wasn't a viable host. So they just sent him off into the galaxy to live his life, and everyone crossed their fingers hoping he'd have a child that could contain his power. He fell in love and had Rey, and we know the rest. I'm on the fence for this development. On the one hand, we're taking an already insanely convoluted story and making it even more complicated. But on the other, I think this is Carson trying her hardest to preserve what she can for people who were a fan of Rey just being Rey and not having a bloodline. I appreciate that, but it just doesn't land for me. Again, I'm ultimately not overly bothered by this because me liking the Rey Palpatine reveal wasn't dependent on finding out when and how the Emperor had a son. The details were never the problem for me, it was the big story decision that never sat well with me in the first place. On the more positive side of things, let's talk about Leia. She has some really great scenes in the book, since Carson wasn't limited by a handful of unused scenes from the previous two movies. We learn that her spacewalk in The Last Jedi took a great toll on her, but that she was refusing to let go until she did all that she felt she could. We learn that Luke has been talking to her since he became one with the Force, and he's there to encourage and comfort her in her final moments. Her motivations and everything that goes on between her and Ben when she reaches out to him are all more clear. I wouldn't say there are any surprising revelations, it's all stuff you can gather from watching the movie, but I'll admit I appreciated having it spelled out for me a little bit more through Leia's inner monologue. That leads us into Ben being abandoned on the Death Star after Rey stole his TIE Whisper. We know he used an Imperial TIE fighter to reach Exegol, but that raised some questions because that ship doesn't have a hyperdrive. We're getting into nerdy nitpicks here, but yeah, I think it's valid to wonder how he was able to get from point A to point B. Carson says he found a scout-class TIE in a Death Star hangar. In Legends, that was a very different-looking fighter that was equipped with a hyperdrive. Even though the look for the TIE Scout has changed for The Rise of Skywalker, I think we can just assume it's not a standard TIE, and this one has a hyperdrive. That's really all you need to know. And finally, let's talk about Lando and Janna at the end of the film. Their interaction led people to question whether or not the two characters were related, especially because the visual dictionary included some deleted dialogue about how Lando had an infant daughter that was kidnapped by the First Order. I've already talked about this, but no, they're not related. Lando just sees this as an opportunity to help someone that needs it, someone that he can relate to because his daughter was kidnapped. But there's nothing else to suggest any actual familial relationship. And those are all the big questions answered by the novelization for The Rise of Skywalker. If you're interested in reading the book for yourself, you can pick it up for free on Audible. Just click on the link in the description or visit www.audibletrial.com/StarWarsExplained. Signing up for a free 30-day trial will get you a credit for one free audiobook that you can use on The Rise of Skywalker or just about any other Star Wars book you can think of. Or get any book you want. The point is, you get a free audiobook and you'll be supporting the channel when you do. But that's it for today. If you haven't already, please like this video, subscribe to the channel, follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook, and consider checking out our Patreon page. As always, thanks for watching, and may the Force be with you.